Well, good afternoon, good morning, or good evening, depending upon where you are in the world, and welcome to today's DevOps.com webinar. I'm Charlene O'Hanlon, moderator for today's event, and I welcome you. We have another great webinar on tap for you today, but before we get started, we do have a few housekeeping items we need to go over. First of all, today's event is being recorded, so if you miss any or all of the event, you will be able to watch it later on. Following today's webinar, we will be sending out an email that contains a link to access the webinar on demand. And we are taking questions from the audience. So if at any time during today's presentation you have a question for our speaker, please don't wait, don't hesitate, just use your GoToWebinar control panel and submit your question. And we'll try to get to as many questions as we can near the end of today's webinar. We also are doing at the end of today's webinar a drawing for three $50 Amazon gift cards, easy for me to say. So please stick around and hopefully you'll be one of our three lucky winners. All right, with that, we'll go ahead and kick off today's webinar, which is how to provide real-time energy management through smart metering and time series, or exploring IoT time series data with eSoftLink and InfluxDB. Our speaker today is Samuel Chevrier, and I know, Samuel, I apologize. I did not pronounce your name correctly, so bad for me. But he's technical marketing engineer at eSoftThings. Samuel, welcome. Thanks for joining me today.
Thanks a lot, and no worry about the name. It's okay.
Okay, great. Well, I know you've got a great presentation ahead, so I'm going to put myself on mute and let you get to it.
Okay, thank you. So hi, everybody, and thank you for joining this webinar. So the title is Exploring IoT Time Series Data with eSoftLink and InfluxDB. So what are we talking, what we will see into this webinar? So here is the agenda. So first, I will talk a bit about the company I work for, so eSoftThings. Then I will explain what are the today limitations that we see in existing smart metering network. So maybe you'll see some similarities with what you know today on your side. And then how to transform a smart meter into an IoT node, what we did to transform it. A little more detailed overview of eSoftLink platform feature list. I will explain the GDPR restriction, so how we take care about data privacy, more deep look on the eSoftLink architecture, the volume of data that we exchange, and the test we've done to validate InfluxDB integration in our system. And I will end by a demonstration, and there will be two kinds of demonstration. I will demonstrate the administration panel for the utility that we've done. And I will also demonstrate the app, the mobile app for the end user to monitor his own energy in real time. Okay, let's go for it. First, a little bit about eSoftThings. So who we are? We are a tech company. We are solution focused. We've been founded in 2014. We are based in Rennes in France. So this is the Brittany part from France. It's not that far from Paris, so 1 hour and a half by a speed train. Our business and market is mainly abroad, I would say, 80% abroad, France, and mainly located in Europe, North America, and Asia. The fundator and the founder and lots of the engineer here are coming from the telecom and the semiconductor industries. And so we have a qualified team of hardware, software engineer, embedded mobile application and backend software. So we are able to cover the full end-to-end IoT offer from the backend to the mobile app through the IoT node, the embedded part. We've got two business units, one that we called a smart device that is focused on services, IoT and audio and acoustic. And we have as well another business unit, which is autonomous vehicle. They're dealing with complex video processing algorithm for the automotive activity. So such like pedestrian detection, driver monitoring system, seat belt detection, and so on. So this is all about us. And now I'm starting to go more into detail and start to talk about the smart metering. And maybe a first introduction is about the smart metering system that we have in France. So the French example that we call the Linky program. So the smart metering system in France, it comes from a European directive about energy efficiency that has been written in 2012. So it's been a while that is in place already. And it is said that 20% of energy saving must be done by the end of 2020, so this year. To do this, the most of the European countries had to put some tender in place to deploy smart metering network. In France, we choose to do it thanks to PLC, so power line communication. We have lots of data concentrator, so that are located into the secondary substation. To those data concentrator are connected all the smart meter, so which are the Linky meter in the customer house. And those meter are communicating once a day with the data concentrator and sending all the data consumption of the day with a 30-minute granularity period, okay? And what the end user can do is he can connect to a portal and consult the energy consumption on a yearly, monthly, and daily basis, but he can see his power consumption only a day after, okay? So my data consumption from today will be only available end of tomorrow on the website, which is quite not easy for people who want to save money on the bill at the end of the day and who wants to reduce the overall consumption of the house. Why am I saying that? It has been proven that having a real-time feedback tool is really key if we want that people save some energy at the end of the day. So here is a chart, and it's more than one lab that is saying that. So this is the National Science Research Institute. This is the Oxford study as well, and the American Council for an Energy Efficient Economy. So they are all saying the same. As soon as you put a real-time plus feedback tool in the end of the end customer, he will be able to save from 12% to 15% of the energy at the end of the day. And we know how important the energy today. So what we did is transforming a smart meter into an IoT sensor so that people can benefit from the IoT technology to be able to monitor their energy consumption in real time and really act on the energy bill that they have at the end of the day or at the end of the month, let's say. So how we are doing is on the smart meter and on any smart meter, I would say there is always a diagnostic slot, interface slot for people to be able to communicate with it. So we just used this slot, which is called the TIC slot in France. And we plugged in a small IoT node that we've implemented ourselves. This small IoT node connect to the domestic Wi-Fi, to the setup box, and send the data to the IoT platform that we call eSoftLink. So the smart meter is still the one, the metrology tool, okay, this is still the tool that is doing the measurement, but then we are using another mean of communication. Instead of PLC, we are using the Wi-Fi to send real-time the data to the private cloud. The entire chain have been designed and implemented by eSoftThings, which means the IoT node, the IoT platform, and the Android app that helps the customer to monitor his energy in real time. So what is eSoftLink at the end? It's a versatile and robust end-to-end IoT platform. And an IoT end-to-end platform is always the same. It starts by an IoT node that sends, that monitor some data. All those data are sent to a platform that is called eSoftLink here. And then you have a front-end. So either it's admin front-end for the utility to check that the IoT node is transmitting the data correctly, or the customer app to check that the energy is okay at the house and that there is no overconsumption and that he's not reaching the limit, okay? Our platform can run on the edge or in the cloud, depending on customer organization, let's say. And we are providing real-time data collection, management, analytical and reporting tools so that people are empowered and able to control the energy consumption. What are the strengths of eSoftLink solution? It's easy for any customer to have a unique provider to enable its own IoT business. So we are able to design the sensor, the backend, the web application, and the mobile apps. And I think it's a key point here for any who wants to subcontract his own project to have a unique provider. Then real-time monitoring capabilities is also really key. So most of the IoT platform today, you pay based on data management, on the number of message or the quantity of data that will be exchanged. Here is not that solution that we picked up, and the price is not mapped on the data volume or periodicity. The key advantage for the platform is to be able to manage real-time the data. And it's more than 5 billion messages a day that are exchanged on the platform today. Also, a big advantage is it can be hosted on public or private cloud. So you are not married with one cloud provider. You can change from one to the other, or you can install the full solution in a Linux server in your own premises. And also, a topic that is more and more important today is about data privacy. So the respect of GDPR with a careful care of personal data is key for this platform. I will come back on this just later on. What are the feature lists? If you look at this block diagram, it's device management, of course. So dealing with IoT device does also mean that you are able to get the status from it. So either it is connected or not connected, is there a failure, is it sending data on a regular basis, is everything okay? And then you must be able to upgrade the firmware to add some more functionalities or just to correct some bugs that you found or for any other reason. Data collection is one of the first obvious reason. So you deployed some IoT device and you want to check all the data that are monitored and measured by the device, thanks to a data visualization panel. Okay, so with some nice graph, you'll be able to get a quick status of your IoT network. Data storage, so thanks to InfluxDB, we are managing the data storage of the time series. And data analytics is also a must that we are managing on the platform. So it's something to collect data, but you need to act with all those data. So this is the aim of data analytics. So to do some prediction thanks to weather forecast or to do some alerting if the consumption is too high or to be alerted if you just reach the limit of your contract or things like that. Smart contract, thanks to blockchain, is also something we added to the eSoftLink IoT platform. So here it's more about microgrid network management and electricity producer being able to engage and have smart contracts thanks to blockchain with some consumer just in the neighborhood, so that you know where it's coming from the electricity and you still have some contract that is written and that the proof that you have a transaction with and in between the electricity producer and the consumer. So this is the key features from the eSoftLink platform. So we can scale at volume of one message per day or several million message per minute. So it's quite massive. The real-time monitoring I already talked a lot about, and the alerting by email or application using the iOS and Android free notifications. The fact that you can that the platform can be on the edge on a commercial cloud service or even in a private cloud service, we don't mind so much. As soon as there is a Linux server available, we are able to install the full solution and deploy the IoT network. The security management, so we are using some well-known protocol, just like TLS and HTTPS. The protocol that we are using for the data exchange is LWM2M, so lightweight M2M. Integrated AI analytics and a secure connection to the data lake. So at the end of the day, if you want to retrieve the full data flow in one of your server, it's possible. So it's called the data lake output. And the AI analytics, I will maybe come back on it while I will demonstrate the full solution. But we do some nice home comparison feature so that you are able to compare your own electricity consumption with some peer in the same region, in the same topology of house and habitants. Device management, as I said, is the basic, but also the most important, I would say. So we are able to receive some remote logs for debug purpose, for example, as soon as the Wi-Fi connection is still valid, of course, but we have a nice option to get it in Bluetooth if the Wi-Fi connection is dead. So firmware update is a must, and remote debug with auto diagnostic tool. So this is what I just talk about. And an administration console with some customization panel and interface. I will demonstrate the one we've done for Total Direct Energy, which is the utility we worked for one of customer on eSoftLink platform. A closer look on GDPR, why we are compliant and the impact it has into the design. So GDPR means General Data Protection Regulation, and it's a law that has been written in 2016. It's a regulation law in Europe about data protection and privacy for all the citizens of the European Union. So what does it mean at the end, and what kind of feature are covered by the GDPR? So you must provide the right to be forgotten in your platform, okay? So there must be a link that any customer can click or an option that you can find so that you delete all the data of the database that is linked to a person. The right to consult. So any individual can download all data related to his own account so that he can switch maybe from one solution provider to another one. Data portability is extracting all the data related to a person in CSV format to transfer to a different provider. the data log access, you must monitor each access to the database and log all the user details so that you know at any time who is consulting which personal data. And anonymization, there is no personal information stored in the Influx database. So you will not be able to link the data collected from the IOC system to a user profile. I think the same kind of law is ongoing right now in US, and it should be similar in some cases. What is the architecture of the system? So again, it all starts by the IoT node that is securely connected to the eSoftLink platform. Of course, since there are a lot of IoT node deployed, you need a message broker to receive all the message from all the IoT node and just reroute them to the right block. So there are some device management feature for the status and the FOTA. We have one Influx database and another Postgres database for the user profile. We do have some analytics for energy consumption prediction. So thanks to weather forecast tool connection or weather forecast services, we are able to predict what will be your power consumption in the next coming days. Non-intrusive load monitoring. So on the full aggregate power figure that you have, we will be able to say what are the contributors. So how much is consuming the fridge, or how much is consuming all the home appliances, or and so on. So it will be easier for the customer to determine who or what is the biggest contributor at the end of the day, and even if there is a failure of a given devices that needs to be unplugged or powered off. We are doing some clustering as well for home comparison. So when the user is entering the app, he will input his or he will determine his own profile. So, how much square meter is the house? Is it a house or an apartment? What heating system is used? And how much habitant is in the house? And what is the region? Where do you live at the end? And thanks to all this input, we will be able to compare your own consumption with some peer in the same region, and it's a good input for you to maybe rework the house or rework the heating system or rework the window if you see that you are consuming too much compared to similar houses in the region. We do have an alerting system and admin web so that the mobile app can connect to the system and the admin frontend can connect to the full system as well. What type of technologies we are using? We are using our own design message broker connected to Apache Zookeeper, which is the centralized coordination service. We do have Apache Kafka for the data stream processing. We are using Telegraf as the server agent for collecting and sending the metrics and the event from the database. The Influx database, of course, for the management of the time series data. And we are using chart.js to build the nice graphics that we have on the tool. And then one question that you might ask is, why did we choose Influx? So we are collecting data 24 hours 7 at the 1 second rate with more than 10K of devices. So which is a lot of data at the end of the day. I'll let you calculate, but it's a lot. So we need, we had to find a system that is able to manage this kind of flow with very good performances. And this is what InfluxDB is offering to us. We needed as well a scalable solution that can work from maybe 1K devices to 10K or 50K devices. And this is the case with InfluxDB Enterprise Edition, and it was a mess for us. We needed a popular solution because when you say popular, then it's very easy to find some documentation and guidance from the community. And the popularity is also guaranteed the long-term support. And we are also very happy about the support of InfluxDB. And the popularity of the solution, you can just look on GitHub, the number of stars for the solution. It's very popular and we are very happy about it. But at the end, only performance test matters. And this is what we've done with the integration of Influx. So we had to test it and integrate it into the full system to be sure that it was the right solution and our integration was correct. So what we did is a test with 48,000 user emulated. We had one data per second per user, and there was two tags per data to write. So we monitored first the Telegraph server, first the CPU. There were six instances of the Telegraph server in total, and there was three per Linux server. And there was a mean of 63% of CPU usage per server, which is quite good regarding the number of users that and the number of data that we manage. We had so a mean of 460 megabit per second as an overall traffic in and out aggregated. And for the memory, we had 63% of RAM use, 4% of cache. So at the end of the day, the results were very good with the server and with the topology we had for the Telegraph installation. What about Influx now? So we had two instances of InfluxDB in total shared on two servers. And the load for the CPU was 43%, which is all good. We had 360 megabit per second aggregate traffic on both server. And a use of 58% of RAM, 33% of cache, which is very good as well, given the number of user and the amount of data that we manage with the full solution. So we were very convinced by the solution, and this is the one that is in place today that is working well on a daily basis. So now that I talked to you about the full solution, I think it's time to demonstrate what it looks like. So I have some other slide about some nice view on the mobile app, but it's better to go directly to the demonstration. So I will start it right now, or maybe I start by the backend. So for Total Direct Energy, to manage the full network, they have a nice admin UI that you can see here, okay? So they have some KPI on the first dashboard that you see here. So they can see the number of active session. They can see the number of connection a day. They can check the user accounts, the average session duration. So it's 3 minutes a day, okay, which is quite good, and which is a good indicator also. It makes sense for people to connect to the app, but how long they spend on the app to really check the detail, this is what this figure is telling you. the full aggregated energy consumption from yesterday, the instantaneous power. And okay, this tile was a tile that we used in at European Utility Week, so a show that was happened last year, and it was a demonstration for the non-intrusive load monitoring. So the meter was able to count the number of coffee a day, which is a proof that we are able to recognize the power signature of the coffee machine, that he's eating the water and providing the coffee. And then here, if I pause the figures, it will be easier to see. So you can check some other nice figure here. So the number of IoT nodes connection and disconnected, the type of OS used by the people, the evolution of the number of connected IoT device, okay, and the unique connection on the last 10 days. So we have so several steps that we are monitoring with the application. So the eligibility phase. So before being able to connect the IoT node, there are a few checks that we are doing with the Android app. So the user must go very close to the smart meter. He should take a photo of the meter. And this way, we are recognizing, we are doing some image processing. We are recognizing the type of meter that it is. We are checking the Wi-Fi, connection, RSSI, and so on. And we know at the end of the day if the customer is able to run the service or not. Then we have the number of installation and the use of the app, the regular use. Also, here you can check the firmware version that is deployed on the network. So the biggest tile is for one of the latest firmware version. And you can check how much are running each of the version. The number of iOS user with connected IoT node, the same for the Android, and the new IoT node installed. And this is it. Now, this is not the only option that we offer to the utility. There is also a nice user management database, and you can check any of the people that are having the IoT node at home. You can check their account and consult what is happening there. So you can consult, for example, this one is a real test one, okay? All the rest of the user are more dummy user for test, okay? And this one is a real one that we have connected here. So we know the status of the IoT node first. So is it paired? Is it connected? Is it plugged in? What is the firmware? When was updated the firmware last time? The pairing date, the hardware version that is in place, the software version that is in place as well, and so on. So the Wi-Fi RSSI is also here. The phone application, we know the type of phone that is used. And the app version that is used. The consumption monitoring. So here we know in real time what is the power monitored by the IoT node. And here you see we just plugged in a heating system to the meter so that you can see there are some power consumption. About the energy that is monitored by the IoT node. So you can check here what is the energy on the last 24 hours, but you can check it for the week, the month, and the year. Spending, so in euro, what is how much is spent on the power? So it's 0.2 euro for 1 hour, for example, and here is decreasing. You have also more than one rate during the day. The usage evolution, so what is your power consumption habit and how it evolved. Prediction, thanks to weather forecast service connection and your own history, we are able to say what looks like the consumption in the next days. And home comparator, so it's a nice tool that tells you how much you consume compared to the other. So here is not very it's not obvious since it's more dummy data for the cluster for this period. Okay, here is more obvious. Okay, we can know a bit more about the meter. What is the ID of the meter? What are the type of notification that is configured by the user? So the power limit, the energy limit, the spending limit, and so on. So there are many alerts that you can set and that you can configure for you to be notified. So what are the notification that we receive from the IoT node? So Bluetooth connection has been disconnected and so on. The personal information and the GDPR logs. So who consulted the user and what is the user login, okay? So here is the login I'm using to connect to the backend, and you see that I'm consulting this profile. Of course, we have some nice OTA management service. So here you are able to say what is the hardware version of the board, what is the firmware version. You can enable or not the firmware on the backend, and then the IoT node will check and will connect to the OTA services once a day to check if the actual version that is running on the node is the latest one, or if a new one is available and enable for it to download and install. Some small information about my account, and this is all. And now I will just launch the view on the app. Excuse me for a second. I just need to connect the phone. Run a small script and I'll be able to demonstrate it to you. Okay. So this is the mobile app that I'm running on the phone that is right next to me. So this is Luna Adeline. So this is the same profile that I was showing to you on the backend. And this is the type of information that is available for Luna. So she can manage its alert. Okay, so consumption monitoring. So here is enabled the monthly consumption alert. There are some nice prevention that we provide, okay? Just like the fuse limit, we re-implemented the fuse algorithm on the backend so that people can be warned before the meter, before the meter blackout, I would say, okay? So it's a nice one to get. And you have many more. You have budget alert that you can change the threshold, consumption alert, the same daily consumption alert to receive a notification with your daily consumption alert, weekly, minimum power, the maximum power, and some connection loss about the IoT node. You have this nice home comparator tool. So just like last week, we consume, okay, so which means that the cluster for this this user is not that big. There's only 15 similar properties that are having the same and similar configuration. you have some consumption change graph that is nice to see. So basically, any graph that the user can see, the utility can see and check that everything is correct as well. There is the profile here and some more reference consumption here. So what it looks like on the next 7 days, for example, 30 days and 12 months. And then in real time, you can check how much money you're spending, okay? And you can check it's also, you can check the graph, okay? The last 24 hours, 7 days, 30 days, and 12 months. You can check as well the power usage, and it's the same. You have some nice graph as usual for the last 24 hours, for example. And you can check the pricing. So you can get some specific rate, and the rate is not the same along the day. So you can get some nice rate at the end of the day that is maybe nice to use if you want to launch some big devices at home. And the last one is about the alert and the management of the alert. I already showed that one. So the webinar is now over. I hope you appreciate the presentation, and you now understand what is eSoftLink and how we provide the full solution to the utility and what kind of advantage it brings to both the utility and the end user.
Excellent. Excellent. Well, we do have time for questions. So if you guys have a question for Samuel, please go ahead and use your GoToWebinar control panel and submit your questions. I believe we have a couple here that are waiting for us. So why don't I go ahead and jump right on in. Are you using any kind of forecasting tools for both the consumer UI or the service provider UI?
Yes, we do. So we are using the weather forecast services. So that we can predict what is the weather, the power consumption in the next days, because it's very linked to the weather at the end of the day. So if it's cold tomorrow, the heating system will consume more to heat the house as to regulate the temperature of the house. And then based on the historical data of your profile and the weather forecasting, we are able to say, and quite accurately, I would say the feedback that we have on these features are quite good. So we are able to say how much you will consume in the next days. So this is the only forecast that we are using today.
All right, that's pretty cool. Okay, next question here. Can you talk a little bit about the retention policies that you have set in place, and how long do you keep that time series data?
Sure. So here again, we are very happy about Influx retention policy, and we are using it. So on the last 24 hours data, we are keeping the data for every second, okay? And on the last 2 years, we are keeping only the last 10 minutes. Okay, so we are removing data just in between the 10 minutes period.
Okay, all right, great. Plenty of time for questions, guys. If you have one, please go ahead and submit your question. Let's see. What are the requirements for a Linux server for local operation?
Maybe this is something I should come back to you later, but it's not very big. I mean, it can run on any Linux server that you can find on any private cloud provider, which are the same basically that the company are using on their own. So I would say that the requirements for the server are very limited and quite regular. There is no big CPU to get, or at the end of the day, it also depend of what type of network you want to manage, what would be the data volume that you want to manage, and the type of connection, of course.
Okay, all right, great. Roy, if you need more information than that, I'm sure Samuel will be more than happy to follow up with you offline. Just shoot me a quick note there in the question box, and I'll pass it along. Okay, next question. What are some other things that you're planning on for the next iteration of this project?
Good question. So I talked to you about, I introduced the blockchain management that we already have and that is in place. And we see a big move for microgrid management, okay? We see some very nice initiatives in town or in some small area where people are producing the energy on their own. And then it's some contract to be in place between the energy producer and the consumers. So this is something that we had put in place. So thanks to the blockchain, you can be sure that the contract is in place and nobody can say it's not, okay? And then it's a way to validate the transaction between the producer and the consumer. And it's also a way to validate how much you produce thanks to a link with the meter and with the consumption register and the production registers. So it's a very nice use of the blockchain, and I think we will see more and more initiative for microgrid and local energy production.
Nice.
And we do have also some nice move on vehicle to home. So we've conducted some experiments so that when people that are having an electric car, they are coming back home, they plug the electricity plug on the car, and then thanks to the same app that you are able to monitor the charging and to configure the charging of the car. So maybe you don't need to charge the car full speed right now as soon as you plug the electricity. Maybe you just want to get your car maybe 60% charge at 8 a.m. the day after, and not more than that. So it's a way for the utility maybe to regulate more the huge current load that will happen at the end of the day if we all have an electric car when we go back home. Okay, so this is also something that we are doing.
Nice. All right, great. Okay, so last call for questions. If you have one for Samuel, please go ahead and send it along. Let's see, how do you obtain permission from power providers to introduce your IoT device to their smart meter?
It must be a move from the utility so that we know that all the data on the meter are encrypted, okay? And the meter is using a unique encryption key that we must know to be able to communicate with the meter. So the utility is having the list of all the secure keys for all the meter. And during the eligibility phase of the customer, we know, and this is where we are doing some image processing. So we know the type of meter and we know the SERI, the ID of the meter. This way, we have a connection with or in production before sending the IoT node, we will flash the unique key in a secure element on the IoT node so that when the end user will receive the key, this key is able to communicate only with one single meter, which is the one that we had the photo during the eligibility phase.
All right, cool. All right, guys, let's see. I'm going to do one final call for questions. And while we're waiting to see if any more come in, I do want to remind the audience that today's event has been recorded. So if you missed any or all of it, or if you just want to listen to it again, you'll have the opportunity to do so. We are going to be sending out an email after today's webinar that contains a link to access the webinar on demand. The webinar is also going to be living on the devops.com website, so you can always go check it out there. Just go to devops.com/webinars, look in the on-demand section, and it should be right there waiting for you. Okay, it doesn't look like we're getting any more questions in, so I do want to thank everybody who did submit questions. There were some really good ones there, so thank you again. Let's see, before we shut things down, I do want to do the drawing for the three $50 Amazon gift cards. So without further ado, we'll go ahead and do that, and then we'll say our goodbyes. Our first winner today is Catherine S. Our second winner is Michael S. And our third winner is David C. We didn't use last names for privacy issues, but we'll be reaching out to you post-event via email to get your $50 Amazon gift card to you. So congratulations, and spend that money wisely. Also want to thank Samuel for such a great presentation. Lots of really interesting stuff.
Thanks to you for the invitation. I was glad to be here.
Absolutely, anytime. And I also want to thank the audience for joining me today. And this is Charlene O'Hanlon, and I'm signing off. Have a great day, everybody.